Coming down into the main straightaway, it will be Neil Bonnett out in front. Richard Petty is in second. Well, this is going to be it. This will be the final lap of the final race of the 1977 season. There's the white flag. Young Neil Bonnett is in front. The last lap, 2.5 miles to go. Richard Petty goes very high as they go into turn number one. Bonnett drops right down on the yellow line. Pulls out and he pulls out a lead. Neil Bonnett walking away from Richard Petty as they go to turn two. All the racetrack, right down to the bottom of the track and right up to the wall on the exit of the corner. Both these drivers straining. Talk about strain. Look at this. This is Pearson rock kicking at 167, 70 up to 180 miles per hour. Riding Baker's automobile down to that straightaway. That is the ultimate drop.
Feel the madness running through the town. We were freed from the moment that we hit the ground. And the wild man, he laid the thunder down. Do you remember me? Like I remember you. In a sea of pain, you keep shining through. In the midst of time, I can see it now.
Down to the inside. Parsons ready to make his move. Four cars. Who will it be at the finish line? Bonnett holds on to the lead.
Bonnett moving down out of the drop to try and pull that drop, which he's
Earnhardt comes to the inside. It's knuckle to knuckle into turn number three. Earnhardt in front. Bonnett coming back. Here comes Parsons from the inside. The last lap of the 12th annual Talladega 500, what a classic! $249,000 in stake. Here they come to line. Neil Bonnett, the Alabama gang, is in front. Corner. Earnhardt finishes. He hits. Kennie Childers. They picked it up. To the line. It will be Neil Bonnett. The Alabama gang holds it off. The crowd ecstatic. And the local boy has got it. They haven't won. Neil Bonnett of Hueytown, Alabama, the protege of the great Bobby Allison, has won here for a home state crown.
Flag, one lap later, he took the checkered flag and won the 1981 edition of the famed Southern 500. He led on seven occasions on the afternoon for a total of 216 laps, and his average speed was 126.446 miles per hour. And when he turned his car into the winner's circle, it was the first time he'd been there since 1980, when he won at Talladega. And it was not hard to see that Neil Bonnett was a happy young man yesterday.
You know, this Thunderbird, the Wood Brothers, has been so close to winning races all year. And we've had a lot of races, and, you know, now to win a race with the Woods and National Engineering, Warner Hodgson, you know, it's awful nice to win a race. And we had a big lead there, but it takes a little bit away when the caution come out. But then to win it as close as it was, it's better for the fans, and I know I'll enjoy it a lot more.
Actually, what were your feelings when your mirror filled up with one Darrell Waltrip in that number 11 Mountain Dew machine?
Well, everybody here knows the kind of competitor Darrell is. If there's any way to win the race, you know, he's going to run the car as ragged as he could and do one heck of a job in his car. And I felt like the place he would try me would be in the middle of 3 and 4, and all I could do was on that last lap was try to pick the best part of that corner and use it.
Did you play a little along the way?
Yeah, I tell you what, I felt like something should have happened.
Out in the lead, Bonnett could feel for gas. He suffered a similar late-race engine blowout in May at the Mason-Dixon 500 on the same Dover track, allowing Jody Ridley to win. Bonnett averaged more than 119.5 miles per hour and moved to the $19,000 winner's purse. Darrell Waltrip finished second and Bobby Allison third, putting Waltrip ahead now of Allison by 2 points in the Grand National Points Race.
But was it a lap too soon? The question is, did Bonnett let him go by or did Waltrip beat him into the corner? Bonnett may still have something up his sleeve. Neil Bonnett into turn one retakes the lead. The Ford is back out in front. Ed Bonnett from Hueytown, Alabama, looks to win his third race of the season. There's time, though, for one more exchange at the south end of the speedway. Waltrip did it a lap ago. He's got one more shot. They lap by John Anderson, a blur at the bottom of your screen at 160 miles an hour. Here comes Yarborough. Yarborough, bottom of the racetrack. He's got Waltrip, and that will let Bonnett slip away. It'll be Bonnett out of turn four, all the way to the checkered flag. Waltrip is second by inches over Cale Yarborough. And the Ford of the Wood Brothers of Patrick County, Virginia, comes to victory lane and standing in the Wood Brothers' pit, race grand marshal Edsel Ford the second, and what a happy man he must be.
The path is a tough challenge for Bill Elliott.
I think Elliott now will try to just kind of sit there. He's got a couple laps to go. I think he's going to try to find himself some sort of weak point. If he can do it coming off the turn, going into the turn, he seems to be stronger right in the middle of the corner. And with one lap to go, he's going to have to do it. He's going to take a look on the inside.
White flag, he's got to do it now. Less than a lap to go of the 400 that they started this long, grueling crusade. Here goes Elliott, trying the outside line down the backstretch. Nothing there. Tucks in behind Neil Bonnett. 3 and 4 will decide the issue. $450,000 on the line. Elliott looks to the inside, slips up on the outside. He'll try the long way around. They're off turn four. They're coming to the checkered flag, and Neil Bonnett will win the World 600. Well, Dick, he held on. That's all you can say. He held the kid on.
Yeah, what a finish. I'll tell you, you go down 600 miles and you see a car a couple feet apart. That's racing.
They battled all afternoon long, 4.5 hours.
Some like this, some like that, and some don't know.
Together, turn 3 and 4. Could it be Rudder Allison? They're right together also.
Ed into turn number three. Neil Bonnett still has the lead, but Darrell Waltrip is going to make one final bid to the inside. Now he looks low to the inside. Coming off the corner, he's not going to be able to do it. Neil Bonnett wins. Waltrip, second spot. In third place, it is Ricky Rudd. And fourth, Bobby Allison, although they cross almost side by side.
Straightaway, and it looks like Gant all the way. He's got the advantage.
He really does. He gets up a little bit too high in turn three.
Here comes Bonnett. Gant comes down to the bottom, and they touch. Gant gets a little out of shape. He's on the outside, but here comes Bonnett. It is close to call.
I have no idea.
Too close to call. Bonnett's momentum carried him ahead of Gant into turn one. Here they are. Gant's way up high on the racetrack, and he tries to come down on Neil Bonnett.
He tries to close off the inside, but Bonnett gets his car alongside. He just pushes Harry up the racetrack. See, he's got the right front up against the left rear quarter panel, and that's pushing the Skoal Bandit up the racetrack.
Gant's car gets a little bit out of shape there. Here comes the Budweiser Chevrolet of Bonnett. Labonte's right behind him. He's got nowhere to go. And lake speed's not a factor. Now, that's the restart stripe. That's not the finish line. Bonnett pulls up closer, ever closer. Gant trying to hold that momentum. Here comes the finish line. Oh, and give it to Neil Bonnett. Matt Jarrett is in victory lane for Motor Racing Network Radio. Let's listen
Neil,
in.
Congratulations. What a run. Man, I tell you what, you know, these boys, Budweiser, Junior Johnson team, they've done a heck of a job. And, you know, we had some bad luck when the season started. I knew that if this thing just ran 500 miles, it'd win a race. It's just too strong not to.
Well, you had your hands full there at the end. Gant got by you. What were your thoughts then?
Well, when Harry went by me, he slipped a little bit going in one and two. And I said, if he'll just slip in three, let me get my foot in the door. Sure enough, enough me to get up under him. And, you know, just all I could do to get by him. Harry's a heck of a racer. Labonte was putting on a good show. Ned, it's been so long since I won one of these things. I tell you, it's a great, great feeling.
Well, it certainly has to be. Neil, did you feel when you came across the start-finish line that you had it?
Yeah, I could tell just about 50 foot before the start-finish line was even. Then I saw my car just roll ahead maybe a foot and a half, and that's all we need. I'll take it.
Since 79, he's had four crashes in this race when he made every effort to win it. But right now, after a third and 82 and a fourth and 83, it looks like it may be coming around. Harold Kinder taking that white flag in his right hand, about to put it out. It's down, and the last lap is underway for Neil Bonnett. Bessemer, Alabama, going down into turn number one. Last circulation around this better than mile track. He'll have himself a new record if it all hangs together. Beautiful race for Bonnett today, and what a surprise. A good surprise for Neil Bonnett. Here he is for Tim Brewer and company, who had a disappointing season. Great way to come back. Neil Bonnett wins his 16th Winston Cup race by 2.5 seconds over the Ford Thunderbird. Ricky Rudd, Darrell Waltrip will complete today in third. Harry Gant is in fourth, and Buddy Baker is in fifth.
Even if he did not cut a tire or rub a tire hard enough, because he can hang on, he can win this thing.
He's showing 398 on the board. We're getting down towards the finish. Car number 75, Neil Bonnett, by his fingernails and toenails, clutching to the side of this rock, which is called the Richmond Fairgrounds. White flag, one lap to go. It'll be worth almost $300,000 to get on plan one, plus the victory here today, if Neil Bonnett can hold on this last lap. Now, he is some gritty guy.
And I can assure you the first person that's going to hug his neck is Dale Earnhardt, because they are partners.
Here they come down to the line to finish it this afternoon. The checkers are out.
This 1.01 mile racetrack at North Carolina Motor Speedway. Lake speed is dropping back just a little bit, apparently convinced now that he just doesn't have it to pass Neil, and he's going to settle for a second place finish.
Well, maybe Neil, does he have a guess? Maybe it's low on gas. I don't know.
Yeah, I think he's going to finish. Here they come off of corner number four. Neil Bonnett from Hueytown, Alabama, wins the Goodwrench 500. Second is Lake Speed. And here comes third. Sterling Marlin pulled away from Alan Kowicki in the closing laps to finish third. Kowicki was fourth. And finishing in the fifth position is going to be Dale Earnhardt. Neil Bonnett is on a roll. There is no question about that. The second consecutive Winston Cup victory and the third consecutive NASCAR victory for Neil Bonnett. Down to the pit area and Jerry Punch.
Well, Neil Bonnett climbing out of the Valvoline Pontiac, and his wife Susan comes in and gets a big hug and a kiss, and Neil could barely stand up. First of all, Neil, congratulations on a tremendous win.
Boy, Jerry, I can't tell you how much the RahMoc team has worked this winter. And you know, our sponsors, Valvoline, all the people have been with us. Budweiser's been with me, and it's just a good day for all of us. I'm telling you, it was a tough day. We kept getting behind, we'd come back. We'd get behind, come back. The car just ran super all day.
Well, Butch Mock and Bob Rahilly worked awfully hard, but how about those tires? You got to be pretty pleased.
I tell you what, Bob Newton's been working with us all year with his Hoosier tires, and, you know, we took a little bit of a beating on qualifying, this weekend, but I just felt like they'd be good in a race, and they showed up. They just kept coming back. You know, Goodyear's been good with us through the years, and all you're going to see is Goodyear build better tires, and they'll be in here mixing it up with us again. So, you know, Goodyear and Hoosier both got something good to race with.
We at ESPN went to your house back last fall, and it was almost a tearful evening. You were sad. You weren't sure whether your career was over. You said, I'm going to come back whatever it takes. I'm working awfully hard. It's got to feel awfully good to you to come back now. Two wins in a row, you're back on track.
Well, I tell you what, Jerry, you know, a lot of that had to do with the fans, and I can't thank them enough. I laid down, you saw me hit down there trying to get ready to go, and I didn't think I could do it. And I kept having a lot of people talk to me and a lot of doctors work with me. We came back, and I tell you what, it's certainly been worth it. My team worked just as hard as I did all winter, and hopefully I can pay them back.
What a tremendous comeback. Neil Bonnett wins the Goodwrench 500 here at Rockingham.
And he won it after he started in 30th position.
Down off of corner number four, the racetrack is almost blocked. It was blocked at one time, and there is Ernie Irvin as his car.
Wow, it's a mess this time.
It is badly, badly damaged. The driver compartment, however, stayed intact. You can see that Ernie is in perfect condition. Just, I'm sure, very, very disappointed with the way that his day has gone. The second time this afternoon that he has lost it coming off of corner number four, or at least had a problem coming off of corner number four. Rick Wilson's number 75 car in the 52 machine of Jimmy Means involved. The number 11 car of Jeff Bodine is on pit road. And watch what happened between Ernie Irvin and Ken Schrader, which involved a lot of other cars eventually.
This had been going on for two laps. These guys had been side by side for two laps. And we've talked all day. This racetrack is tough. It's too tough to team. And you just can't do it. We see Ernie got a little bit sideways. He bumps Schrader. They spin. There, Sterling Marlin runs in the back of the six car. And then he also hits the four car. Meanwhile, Jeff Bodine, they ran in the back of him, but he came through with not too much damage. Also, Morgan Shepherd, Dale Earnhardt, Brett Bodine. That looks like Bobby Hillen.
Somehow, Bodine, Earnhardt got through. Brett Bodine got through for the most part. Here it is from our speed shot just off of corner number four.
There's just no place to go. These fellas have blocked the racetrack completely, but Jeff Bodine.
Yeah, unscathed. So is Morgan Shepherd. The guy that took the real hard knock, it appeared, was Sterling Marlin, the 94 car. Well, Ernie gets tagged pretty good there by Ricky Rudd and gets tagged again by somebody. Well, we got another angle.
Once they get sideways again.
And they touch.
They
and
touch.
Around they go.
Man.
There you can see how Sterling Marlin got hit pretty good there a couple of times. And now you thought that was spectacular. Watch this and listen to this. Can't
got through okay. Now this is from Ernie Irvin's car, looking out back. And Jerry Punch is with Ernie Irvin. Well, the wall, there is the Darlington Stripe. You've heard so much about the Darlington Stripe, and there are several that have fallen victim to that just in the last few minutes. Here are the cars that were involved in that multi-car tangle coming off of corner number four. Rudd, Irvin, Moroso, Wilson, Bonnett, Mean, Schrader, Martin, Marlin, and Waltrip. Now, not all of those cars are out of the race, but those are the ones that were involved in some way or another with the crash off of turn four.
As they continue to try to sort this race out.
Caution.
Yellow is back on the track. We got a major crash through the tri-oval. Car on fire coming to the line right here in front of us. It's Ted Musgrave's car, front and rear. And Bonnett's car is also involved in the incident. There are four, five cars that have crashed here in the tri-oval. There is Neil Bonnett's number 31, torn up front and rear. The Musgrave car is torn up. He's told his crew that he is okay. You're in Neil Bonnett's car. After it took a serious hit, you see the crew coming out, some of the safety crew coming out to that car. There's the 55 of Musgrave.
Fireman right Johnny on the spot to put that fire out because it was right in the fuel cell area.
Lap 131. Bonnett's car lies in the grass just at the bottom of the track as you exit pit road.
Wow, his car got upside down and then comes back on the wheels as we see Musgrave's car sliding up against the wall, flames coming from it as he comes across the start finish line
into the catch fence with the Neil Bonnett car number 31.
You can see the debris, a tremendous amount of it
from inside of Bonnett's car.
Wow, that's the kind of lick that Neil didn't want to take, but look at him, he's crawling out of it. That's good news. All right.
Neil Bonnett, okay. Last race, 1990. A life-threatening crash at that time. He said, I have to come back. I've got to run it one more time.
Didn't want the doctors to tell him he had to quit. He wanted to do it on his own.
Taking a look back at this car number 31, which is the car that Earnhardt had driven in the Firecracker 400 down at Daytona. Neil looks okay. Let's see here as he walks away. Looks like he's okay. Let's listen and look again. Neil Bonnett's incident.
Finally, tragedy struck the sports world again Friday. For the third time in 10 months, a NASCAR driver lost his life. Neil Bonnett died of injuries sustained from a head-on collision while practicing for the upcoming Daytona 500. The winner of 18 Winston Cup victories was 47 years old.
The loss of Neil Bonnett in a practice accident here on Friday afternoon. Neil was looking forward to a six-race schedule this year. He was one of the most popular drivers in NASCAR Winston Cup racing and had become a very popular broadcaster as well. And certainly he will be missed in the sport. Lots going on here at Daytona for the next 10 days. For more on our tribute to Neil Bonnett, let's join Bill Weber in our studios in Charlotte, North Carolina.
Thank you, Ned, and good morning, everyone. It has been a difficult couple of days. We've lost a friend and a colleague. And in a moment, we'll glance into the past to recapture some of the many happy memories Neil Bonnett shared with all of us.
Inside Winston Cup Racing is brought to you by cold-filtered Miller Genuine Draft and Miller Genuine Draft Lite, taking the country by storm. Goodyear, number one in tires. And by Haviland Formula 3 Motor Oil. Add more life to your car.
Neil Bonnett brought enthusiasm and energy to the racetrack. He said his desire to get to the front and stay there probably cost him more times than he'd like to admit, but he enjoyed it all. Neil's no longer with us, but we will always have fond memories of his smile and his style.
Neil Bonnett's cheerful smile and pleasant personality were homespun trademarks of this high-riding member of the Alabama gang. For 20 years, he was a part of the Winston Cup racing community, first as a driver, then a broadcaster, and last year returning to the track in Talladega, the site of his first Winston Cup race. Bonnett celebrated 18 Winston Cup wins, beginning in Richmond in 1977. His long relationship with the Wood brothers took Neil to victory lane 9 times, including the World 600 at Charlotte in 1982. The following year, in a RahMoc Chevy, he flashed across the finish line 8-tenths of a second ahead of Richard Petty for back-to-back wins in the 600. He won twice in 83 and 85, and at Rockingham in 86. 1987 was interrupted by a shattered leg suffered in this crash at Charlotte. But in 1988, Neil was comeback driver of the year. He took Hoosier tires to victory lane for the first time with a win at Richmond. His last victory came 2 weeks later at the North Carolina Motor Speedway in Rockingham.
Well, it's almost too much to think about. I've always liked to take things week at a time, one race at a time, but my goodness, our bunch is stout right now. Our team's running. We're up there in the points thing. If we can maintain this consistency, we'll be a factor all year, I believe.
In 1990, Bonnett sustained severe head injuries in this crash at Darlington. Neil suffered memory loss and underwent long-term physical therapy. When he had this conversation with Randy Pemberton in July of 1990, it appeared his racing career had ended.
I should have had a lot more wins. I probably should have won twice as many races as I won, but I'll be the first one to tell you, if they let me regroup and go back through there again, I'd do it the same way. I had fun doing it. I enjoyed it. My numbers aren't all that great, but I tell you what, nobody had any more fun than I had doing it.
Neil really never left the sport. He moved into broadcasting, winning new fans as a race analyst. And he worked with his 29-year-old son, David, as he attempted to join the Busch Series. Neil patiently massaged his desire to return to racing. Then last year, with doctor approval, he returned to the track after a 3-year absence, qualifying for the Diehard 500 at Talladega. This year, Neil planned to run a limited schedule. He was excited about the opportunity to climb back behind the wheel and compete again in the sport he loved so much. Neil Bonnett collected 18 Winston Cup wins, 20 poles, and nearly $4 million in career earnings. He leaves behind his wife Susan, his son David, his daughter Kristen, and millions of racing fans and friends who will long remember his soothing smile and southern charm.
I can't tell the people enough, the fans out there, the cards and the letters. I'm not talking about the Neil Bonnett fans. I might put them in one sack. And I'm talking about the Darrell Walters, the Dale Yarbers, the Pettys, the Allisons that sent letters that we're a Walter fan, but we sure appreciate the effort you made in racing. And I'd like to take the opportunity to thank the fans. You never can pay the fans back enough. They stand on the other side of that fence hanging on, pulling for you. When you're down, they pull even harder, and I appreciate that.
Equally eloquent in his silence has been Dale Earnhardt. Earnhardt has said, "I am not ready to share my feelings with anyone about Neil Bonnett. The safest place for me to be right now is in my race car on that racetrack." But for us who have followed Winners from its inception, we can share some moments with Dale and Neil from that very first episode and some other moments from Winners.
You better move.
I got the idea.
Oh, I ain't caught that 11 pounder right here.
Who?
Hank.
Ooh, let me get out there and help. See if I can find it. Put it back in.
Yeah. Then you put it in there to start with.
Ernie said that you put that deal together for him. Y'all rode by and you lined up all the sponsorship, but Earnhardt was going to pay for it. He says that he never got anything. He's claiming that maybe you got, like, he said he got a few parts and maybe you got $2,000 and kept it. That's not my contention. If you kept it, we won't air this if I get half of it.
Well, you know,
Junior Johnson's training school was these little winding, twisting, crooked roads through these mountains in rural North Carolina. He was trying to outrun the revenuers hauling moonshine, a race he had to win. If you roll this window down and stick your head out and the wind's blowing just right, you can still smell that good old sour mash in these mountains. Just in case y'all heard a little bit of noise in the background, this right here is the culprit. And you think racing's a handful. There you go. Try that for a while.
She's a handful, but she's great.
He's different from most of the Winston Cup drivers. For one thing, he's a northerner. For another, he's got a college diploma.
Here's what I get for not reading the questions ahead of time. While you were juniors, here comes a second team rolling in. Guess who? It was me.
Yeah.
And, you know, there's times, Darrell, that the thing just doesn't work. Just like the deal at Nashville. You know, it's on the... Why have I got to ask? I didn't even want to bring this up. But anyway, the two-car team, at times there's always something going to pop up that causes a problem. And the deal at Nashville, you know, I said I won, you said you won, but best I remember, you got the trophy, so you won the race. But it does cause problems having two cars run out of the same place like that.
Well, it did.
So this guy calls me up, and he says, won't you come be on the show in Nashville? Okay, I'll come do it. You know, that's my one appearance. I'm going to get it out of the way. I'm going to be over with. Then you just send me my check.
Raking the money.
We're going to make millions. We're going to make more than Slim Whitman made off his TV album. I'm telling you, we're going to make a bunch of money. So I leave there and get on a plane and fly to California because we're racing at Riverside at that point in time. So I get off the plane out there, and I'm talking to some fans and stuff, and they said, hey, man, we saw you in Nashville. Saw you on Nashville Now. And I said, Rick? I said, were y'all just in Nashville on vacation or something? And they said, no. I said, well, how'd you see it? Oh, we get it on TV out here. And I said, what do you mean you get it on TV? And they said, you've never seen Ralph Emery? And I said, no, I don't know who Ralph Emery is.
I thought
it was like a Nashville program. You know what I mean? And like 500, a million people in Nashville is going to see it. But the rest of the country's not going to know how bad a singer I am.
Neil Bonnett was a great host of winners. He was equally great as a TV analyst, as your sidekick in the booth. He had an innate sense about what people needed to know, and he could communicate it so not just race fans, but so everyone could enjoy it. He was a tremendous ambassador for the sport. For my nickel, he was the best analyst in the history of the game.
They're averaging 150 miles an hour around this place now. That's between 165 and 170 miles an hour going in turn one right here. Very tough. It's like slot cars around this racetrack. There's 2 1-mile tracks on the circuit, Rockingham and Dover. This place is 2 seconds faster. Drivers are going to have to stay on top of the race cars or they're going to be in a lot of trouble. The monster just got meaner.
No one was ever a stranger to Neil Bonnett. And perhaps that is the greatest gift he leaves us.
Do you realize that until the winter show on National Network came along, Hueytown was best known for the Hueytown hum? Gives you pause for thought, doesn't it? Just kidding, Bobby, Donnie, Davy, and Hutt.
Folks, step into my laboratory, and let me give you a demonstration of one law of physics that the 1992 Winston Cup champion Alan Kulwicki would agree with. When you're hot, and when you're not. Now, y'all just think about that.
When I see that, I'll be the first one to tell you, standing in front of this camera and not in that race car is not where I want to be. But I'll also be the first one to tell you I don't have any animosity to any driver on a racetrack for an accident. That's racing. You're going to put cars in places they shouldn't be at times. But when you're real, real careful, you don't win a lot of races. I was already living here in Hueytown. I was working as a pipe fitter, and I was racing on the weekends. Then comes Bobby Allison, takes me under his wing, and we all went racing together. The Alabama gang. Me, Bobby, Donnie, and Red, all in a row. We used to love to hear people say it was our genius that made us winners. I'm here to tell you it was because we all stuck together.
Hey, wait, hold, time out, guys. Wait just a minute. This is my den, my show. You got my sweaters on. And watching my wrecks and getting a chuckle out of it.
Yeah, well, Neil.
Wait a minute. Oh, don't tell me to wait a minute. Crap, gotta stop.
Wait a minute. Sit down here.
Whoa, wait a minute. This is mine.
Well, no. Sit down here. Watch this. You ain't believe this one. This is good stuff now. We've been watching this for quite a while.
Yeah,
this,
but I heard you laughing down here.
No. This is Daytona. You blew up the start finish line.
You ain't never wrecked.
And you slid by. You just missed the end of this wall. Watch this. Just missed. Ooh. Was that close? You had control of it, didn't you?
Make that move right there.
That's true. That is.
See, this is good stuff.